Welcome to my program, Taslima ji. I just can't believe that I am sitting next to you. I've been such an ardent fan of yours for so many years. Thank you so much for sparing time for me. I know that you have a very busy schedule and you are flying out of the country, I think, day after tomorrow or some such date maybe. So I'm so happy that my viewers will be able to hear you directly. And what I want to know is that you as a person have been a pioneer in many aspects. And you also, how did you have this vision about what you have spoken about in your books, your views, and you had the courage to take on an entire community, an entire government. How did you do that? And how did you come to become an atheist and also a pioneer of women's causes? I think these two causes are closest to your heart.
You know, I was never a religious person. I always, I was a very curious child. So I asked my mother about God, about religion. My mother couldn't answer, you know, properly. And my father was an atheist. My mother became a religious person, and she asked me to read the Quran or pray namaz. But you know, I read the Quran in Arabic and I didn't understand the meaning of the verses that I read. I asked the meaning of the verses to my mother, and my mother said that it is not important to know the meaning of these verses because Allah will be happy if you read the Quran in its original language. So I was very curious. I said, Ma, you said that Allah knows everything. Doesn't Allah know Bengali if I read the Quran in Bengali or pray namaz in Bengali? Because namaz also, you know, everybody has to pray in Arabic. Most of the people actually in non-Arabic countries do not understand the surahs or ayahs that they utter. I was very curious, you know. My mother said, don't say any bad thing about Allah, then your tongue will be fall off. I was very scared. Then one day I went to my our bathroom and locked the door, and I said, all the bad things that I could say, I said, and then I found that my tongue was
in
my mouth.
Falling off. It's not fallen off.
No, it means that my mother was not right. Anyway, because I was very curious, I wanted to know what is written in the Quran. I found the Quran, Bengali translation of the Quran when I was 11 or 12 years old. Then I read the Quran and I was very shocked, because I found lots of inequalities and injustices against women in the Quran. And I thought that, I cannot believe in this. No superpower, no God who created all billions of planets and billions of galaxies and stars, and who's so powerful, powerful God cannot do injustice and inequalities against women. Women are His creatures, women are human beings, so why is it? Then I actually didn't believe in Islam anymore. Actually, from the beginning I was curious, I really didn't believe, but there was maybe, if I found that that Quran is wonderful, you know, if I found the evidence of existence of God, maybe I would have believed. But I didn't find anything, not any equality and justice in the Quran. I didn't consider the Quran as a holy book, and I didn't find any evidence of the existence. So I just rejected Islam, and not only that, I read the other religious texts too, and I found that there are lots of injustices and inequalities against women in those texts. So the God is a misogynist, if there is any God. So I cannot believe, or I cannot trust, or I cannot respect any misogynist God. So I really, and then afterwards I read science, and I started believing science, and I didn't believe in any God or religion. I think that we can be good without God. We don't need God for becoming a better person. But anyway, I respect you very much. I have seen some of your videos, and they are wonderful. What you are doing in this superstitious and religious society, it's extraordinary. And I really want to know about Hinduism from you.
Thank you so much for your lavish compliments. It's very precious to me coming from a person like you. So thank you very much, and you also give me, you know, more confidence to go ahead with what I am doing. I would not say that I know a lot about my religion or any other religion. So I'm actually the wrong person to ask me about religion. What I know is only what I am seeing around me. It's not that I have read it, religious texts. But for me, like you, maybe you became an atheist at a very young age. For me, it took me a very long time. It's a very, very long process. But slowly, you know, every time I saw incidents, and then the more I read, the more scientific my mind became. It became scientific not through reading books of science, but more through maybe books of philosophy. Mm-hmm. And arguments, when I hear arguments of stalwarts like, say, Richard Dawkins or Carl Sagan or Christopher Hitchens. But these also I have read after I have converted into an atheist. And I wouldn't really say that whether I'm a converted and a diehard atheist, because we don't really know. Unless I die, how do I know? It's only maybe after death, that if there is life after death, that I will come to know whether there is God or not. But there is, as you say,
guess.
Far I have not seen, yes, as far as I can guess, I don't see there is any evidence of any afterlife. What we have in our religion, this belief of so many rebirth. I don't believe in that. How can a person go on being born again and again? And I think that, you know, it is cruel to tell somebody that if you have today some problem, it is because of sins that you committed in your last birth. Now, I have no memory of my last birth, if at all there was a last birth. And today someone is telling me that because of something happened at that time, so today you have this problem. Mm. It doesn't sound logical at all. Because if it was a punishment for something, or on the other hand, maybe if it's a I had done some good deeds and today I am getting those rewards, but I have no memory of that. So then what is the point of giving a reward to somebody who doesn't know why I am being rewarded or punished? For what for? And there isn't really any scientific evidence of any rebirth or getting heaven or going to hell. I don't really know. And if you think about it and question it, ultimately there are no proper answers. And if you are in a discussion with somebody, then they say, no, you have to believe in it. Don't question.
Blind
don't
faith.
Argue. Yes, don't argue. If you, first thing that you must have is to believe. So that is what we say,
bishash. I don't like to believe bishash, without belief, evidence.
That you must believe. Now, how can I believe something? So you also don't believe?
No, because if I see that, if I get, you know, any evidence of the existence of God, I would start believing.
I would start.
So far, I haven't found any evidence.
Mm.
And you asked me how I became a feminist.
Yes.
You know, because I believe in human rights,
right.
I have to believe in women's rights.
Absolutely.
Because
absolutely,
women are human beings. But in our patriarchal, misogynistic society, women are considered as sex objects or childbearing machines or slaves of men.
Or at least inferior to men.
Yeah, inferior to men. And women are oppressed because of religion, culture, customs, traditions. So I have been fighting against all these anti-women customs, cultures and religion.
And in these parts of the world, you know, the South Asian countries, your country from where you come originally, Bangladesh and India and all these other countries, you will see, if you see the figures of the Human Development Index, UNDP comes out with these figures every year, and you will see that these countries, the ratio is 1 is to 5 something, maybe even lower than that, 1 is to 4, 5. So that means that if a man has 100% rights, then the woman has only 50%, not rights, but also empowerment. So there are certain parameters, like how much wealth a woman has, or how much educated she is, what is her health status. So in all these parameters, women are approximately half of what a man has. So if a man is getting full nourishment, the woman will get only half of it. And if a man has wealth, he has a bank account, average I'm talking about, I'm not individuals, individually there can always be exceptions, but you will see that a woman would have only half of it, whereas the highest, nowhere in the world is it 1 is to 1, the ratio is not 1 is to 1 in any country. In the Scandinavian countries, you are a Swedish national, I think, so in those countries you will see that it is 1 is to 9.9, so that means if a man has 100%, then the woman is 90. But coming down to our countries, it goes lower and lower. And women are look at the status. And you will see that whether it is education or employment or property or wealth, in all these parameters, women are nowhere compared to men.
Yeah, because women...
Education?
Have been, treated as inferior beings. And till now, it's not, women are not allowed to go to school, to study.
Or even if they are studying, after a certain level, then they will be withdrawn from school.
Yeah.
And the brother can study more.
Yeah.
Right?
And women are given into marriage and they are not allowed to go to college or universities. So women are not, women were not allowed to even work outside home, but now
things are changing,
but very slowly
it is changing. But even now, if a woman is employed, she might be highly educated, but even then the end goal somehow seems to be married. That is the goal for a man also. For a woman, it seems as if that is the ultimate, that she must get,
and to give birth to children.
Yes.
And not only that, if a woman earns money and very independent financial freedom, if a woman has, still the money that she earns, she has to give that money to her husband, because husband will decide what he will do with money.
In most cases, in many cases, of course, women can have their own separate accounts and they can take financial decisions to a certain extent. But a woman should not be outspoken. She should not express her views. She should not ask for her rights, or at least equal rights.
Reproduction rights, no reproduction rights. If a woman says that I don't want any children, she doesn't have any right not to have children. And also, if she says, okay, I want only one child, that should be a girl. In this patriarchal society where the boys are very important,
yes, the premium is on the male children.
It's not possible. And women are, what I said, that women are still considered childbearing machines. Now, if women earns or not earns, if women are financially independent or not, it doesn't matter. All women are treated as inferior beings, and the man will take decisions what women should do, where women should go to work, or women should sit at home. Everything will be decided by women, and what women will do with her money, that also decided by men. So women are not decision makers, because women are still considered that not as intelligent as men.
So you asked me about religion, and this conversation from the thought came to me that in our mythology, which is part of our religion, you will see that we have lots of very powerful goddesses, right? Durga, she is the goddess of power, of strength, and then look at Lakshmi, goddess of wealth, and Saraswati, the goddess of learning. But as far as their spouse is concerned, he holds a still higher status. So if it is Durga, but she has to go back to her, she can come to her parents' house only for 4 or 5 days and then she has to go back. So she has permission only for 5 days. If you see Lakshmi and you see that she is sitting at the feet of her husband on, and he is sprawled on the Sheshnag in the middle of the sea somewhere. So even in where the woman is has the status of a goddess, compared to her husband, she is still at his feet. At his feet.
Okay.
So that that is something that maybe that
very
is how we get. That is from where we get the cues of how to behave in society. This gives us the direction, and that is how the beliefs come up.
You know, all religions were created by men for their own interest. Now we should all know about it. We should just, keep state and society out of religion. You know, religion can be a personal matter. If anybody wants to believe, they can believe.
Certainly.
But state shouldn't have any religion, and society, the education system, should be separated from religion.
Absolutely.
We should not go and study religion in schools or colleges. Mm. But there are madrasas, and there are many religious schools which are really not very interesting, not really good.
And then also, because of religion and our belief systems, people become very very conservative, and also fanatics. And they're willing to kill people for their beliefs?
Yeah, especially Islam. You know, there are so many madrasas and mosques in Muslim countries. I can talk about Bangladesh. There are so many peers and hujurs, that maulavis, they are in the mosques and madrasas, they are actually brainwashing children to become fanatics, to become terrorists, and to hate non-Muslims, and this is dangerous. So that, we saw so many young boys became Islamic terrorists. They joined ISIS. Mm-hmm. And then so many atheists were hacked to death in Bangladesh.
Here also in India also, there are people who have been killed because of their rational beliefs,
yeah.
Scientific beliefs. You see these, we have these people, Govind Pansare and
Kalburgi,
yes, absolutely.
Oh,
so
it's very sad.
This has happened here as well, that religion is actually, I think, the primary objective of religion is that people should lead good lives. But if it is spawning violence, if it is spawning hatred, then don't you think that the world would be better off without religion, without belief in God? We are fighting, that my God is better than yours, or my beliefs, you must conform to my beliefs. Mm. Or if you are not believing, if you are going away from the fold, then you should be punished.
Yeah, religion kills. It is full of, violence and all this hatred.
And another aspect which worries me a lot is that the belief, you will see that this belief system is there all around you. We are all subjects of our childhood conditioning. It's very difficult to come out of that conditioning. And even now that peer pressure is there, altogether you will see the society. If you have, say, you are ill, then people will tell you, if you pray, it is going to work. So pray to God if you there is there. Or now it has become fashionable to have this chanting. So you keep chanting and you think that somehow you are going to able to send a message to God, and then He will be merciful and He will take away your illness, or He will cure you.
Already we know that nothing fails like prayers.
There are research studies which say that. There have been academic studies which have shown that whether you are praying or not praying, it has absolutely no effect on your treatment or your illness. But then still people think that it will have a
I become effect. Sad when I see the doctors in big hospital, big doctors are religious. They believe in God. They think that the patients will be cured if they pray to God.
And if they're going for...
They don't believe in medicine. They don't believe in treatment.
If they're going into the theater, so before that they'll just say a quick prayer so that this operation might be successful. And they'll also tell the patient to
Many
have
do.
Faith in God. And sometimes maybe it does give you a positive mind set. And this is, I think, you know, this is a psychological crutch.
No,
that
but lies.
Gives you some
if lies give you happiness, should do if you support
that
lies.
Is, that is, yes. But then you should understand that this is not going to
work.
Yeah,
you know, people study science, but they don't have scientific temper.
They don't have
This is very
temper.
Bad.
Yes, yes. Why
if
doctors
they
alone,
have...
Look at engineers, you know, they're launching a rocket.
And they go to, with a miniature rocket, they go to Mandir.
To pray for the successful launch. And this is there all over the world. It's not that we can say that it's only happening in India or in Bangladesh or any of the neighboring countries. It is there all over the world. Although in other countries you will see that the influence of impact of religion has much reduced.
But we see that civilized countries have much less
religious
people. They go. They don't go to churches.
They don't go now.
The churches are now, you know, empty. They are like museums.
Yeah.
But we are building mosques and mosques and mosques.
And temples, such grand temples coming up. And how much wealth is locked in our temples? It is said that, you know, these many temples have so much wealth that if that was to be taken out, India would not be a poor country anymore. It is unaccounted and it's not even unlocked, because the belief is there that if that wealth is taken out from the temples, then some disaster is going to happen.
Same in Bangladesh. You know, there are, when I was small, in whole area there was one mosque. Now there are hundreds of mosques.
More and more. So the temples are also
and
proliferating.
Only the old people used to go to mosque for praying. But now young people go to mosque to pray. And they block the roads to pray. This is so ridiculous, you know. I think that I really get afraid when young people go to mosque and pray. And they become, many of them became terrorists. All the terrorists, you know, that that killed so many people at Dhaka Cafe. They were all young people. And they were their parents were very religious, and those parents put pressure on those boys to become religious when they were very little,
when they were small children. So that's what I said, that, you know, it is the
they
childhood
brainwashing
conditioning, that kind of a thing that goes on. Very true. So do you think that if we didn't have religion, there would be more peace in the world?
There will be peace, but human beings are very
violent by nature.
I don't think they will find something to hate others and commit crimes.
But I won't totally agree with you, see, because religion is now on the way out in Europe. And when was the last war that was fought between European countries? They are all living peacefully. Like, you can just go from one country to other, you don't even need a visa. You can just go, you can go in the morning, come back in the evening. So see, they have given up religion and they are living very peacefully. There are no wars in Europe anymore.
Yeah, but I don't think personally, it is my personal belief, that maybe there will be some conflicts. I'm not saying that 100% peaceful and it will be forever peaceful. But of course, much more peaceful than what
we are
having. I think so.
Those conflicts might be, you know, related to economic decisions or trade. But it is not of beliefs, and you don't go and kill somebody else because he has some other god, and he's, whether he's praying or not praying, going to the church or not going to the church. So they are all living very peacefully. There are no wars at all in Europe now.
But we never know. But still, I don't think that any country is really 100% peaceful. And still there are conflicts between countries. And then still they think that they have to create democracy in some other countries.
But see,
going there and killing people.
No, that killing is individual based. It is not a group kind of a thing. It is maybe there is one individual person who has some mental illness or whatever his thoughts may be. For some reason, he becomes very radical in thought and so he goes around killing people for unknown reasons or for his own personal reasons. But that is not the same as, you know, one community fighting with another community. That is not happening in
Europe. We have seen that what happened in New Zealand. And one hateful man killed 50
exactly.
Muslims,
yes, Muslim,
in a mosque.
Yes, yes.
And recently,
very sad,
a group of Islamic fanatics or Islamic terrorists killed so many people in churches.
Mm.
You know, so it's kind of religious war.
It's a religious war.
But we thought that religious war was stopped, but still going
it's
on.
Still
the
going.
Hatred between people of different faiths, you know. So I don't know how long it will be continued, but it's very sad that in this 21st century still we cannot stop this hatred between two religious people. But still I think that that the conflict that we see in this world, the conflict is not between, real conflict is not between Christianity and Islam or Hinduism and Islam or Judaism and Islam. I think that real conflict is between secularism and fundamentalism, between religion,
yes,
between the rational, logical mind and irrational blind faith, between innovation and tradition, between future and past,
yes,
between the people who believe in freedom and the people who do not.
So that means in spite of this education, high education, people who have been to colleges and universities, even then, you know, they're not able to develop a critical thought, a logical thought. So is that, would you think that this is a failure of our education system? There should be something imbibed in our education system which makes people not only rational in thought but also able to overcome superstition.
Yeah, our education system is like, okay, study this, get good marks and then you will get good jobs.
But not,
that's all.
That's all.
Not for the real education.
Mm-hmm.
Education, you know, about women's equality.
Mm-hmm.
Where would you find? In school, college, university? Nowhere.
Nowhere.
Education about rational ideas? No, you will not find.
You will not.
Anyway, you know, what I think that, people, when they go to school to study about faith or religion, they should study about all religious faith that we have now in this world, or the many religions were just gone with the wind.
Gone, yes.
Those they have to learn also. Also they have to learn there's secularism and humanism and atheism, that you can choose anyone. You know, nobody was born as with religious faith. They should choose what they would like to do.
Yes.
But you know, the children, I think that if you do not indoctrinate children, then that if you don't force any child to become a religious person or believer, I think that religion will be gone in two generations.
But what worries me is also about the superstitions that are there in our country. See, if you go anywhere, go to any public place, or even when you're sitting in a group of people, you will see that many of them will have so many stones, rings on their fingers and a red thread around their wrist or a black one or something around their neck, and think that this is going to bring them good luck or it is going to help them get over their problems, word of, you know, the evil eye or something like that. So that is prevalent in our country, in our society. It is absolutely so common, it is seeped into our society.
We have to fight superstition by science.
But
you know,
people who have studied science are also doing this.
Yeah, this is very unfortunate. Because they studied science, they don't really believe in science. They studied science only for having a good job.
Yes.
I don't think they really...
I really put it to the failure of our science education, that we are not able to develop a critical and a logical reasoning kind of a mind. You know, looks away, you're questioning.
Because critical and logical kind of mind are not very appreciated in
they
society.
They are not appreciated, absolutely not, absolutely
they would
not.
Be killed.
They will be killed, yes.
Yeah, I have been living in exile, you know, since 1994. So it has been 24 years that
24
I've been
years.
Living in exile, and I'm not allowed to enter my country. Why? Because I have scientific temper and the rational, logical mind. And I was not allowed to live in my country because I was, very critical of religion, because I think that Islam should not be exempted from the critical scrutiny that apply to other religions. And I think that Islam also should go through the enlightened process that other religions have gone through by questioning the unethical, unscientific, irrational aspects of religion. But it's not allowed.
It's not
so because I said that, because I said no, we don't need any religious law, we don't need Sharia laws, we need laws based on equality. Because I opposed Quranic laws, so I should be killed. And because I said that we want women's equality, and as a human rights defender, I question why minority population should be harassed and persecuted only because they have different faith. So I was not allowed to live in my society.
I am quite amazed that you had the courage to do this. You are a unique person that you have been able to fight not only your community, one community, but also governments, and not just the government of one country, but also in India. Some states are letting you
if you
enter
think
them.
That my community
so
is the
really
Muslim
amazed.
Community.
No. Yeah. Yes.
No, my community is secular humanist.
Secular
community.
No, I'm saying that you fought against one, that you could, you were alone in your fight.
Yeah.
It's not that there was an uprising and there were lots of people who were joining you. So you have done it by yourself, but alone.
That banned, censored, banished from Bengal.
So that is something that is really needs a lot of courage to be able to do it and to sustain it for such a long period. Would you say that yours is a lonely battle?
Sometimes I think that I'm fighting alone, but no,
there are so many people who are your admirers. Yes, I am, of course. Yes, definitely. And I hope that this conversation will let our viewers food for thought. They will think about what we have discussed, and maybe there will be some change. I am hopeful, and thank you so much for sparing your very valuable time. Thank you.